That's right. It's the X-Man Podcast. I'm your host, Doc Coyle. Thanks again for listening to the show. We've had quite a run. Last month, actually, was my biggest month of the show. And so thank you to everyone who's been supporting the show. You know, and I think it has everything to do with just the consistency, you know, with which I've been releasing. I've been releasing every Tuesday. Just is the first time since I've been doing the show that it's been consistent. And I think I've had one every week for 9 weeks, I want to say. But clearly this is represented because of being home and the pandemic and all that, not being on tour, which really can kind of screw up with the schedule for me at least. And yeah, I just I appreciate all of the support and the fact the show seems to be growing, or at least, you know, and it's a very glacial pace. You know, the podcast game, it's not like one day you're nobody, the next day you're Joe Rogan. But anyway, I thought tell you guys should know that it's pretty cool. And I'm just, like I said, I'm going out there still trying to get the greatest guests and all that. But, you know, I would feel remiss not to talk a little bit about this last week. I, you know, struggle internally sometimes with how political I get on here, because, you know, I really don't want to turn anyone off to the show. Even if you go on Apple or the Apple podcast and see the reviews, there's a couple people like, Mr. Lefty Liberal Guy. And I don't really want to be that. I would like this show to be for anyone, really. And I mean that sincerely. So I always get a little uncomfortable about being too overly vocal. But I feel like this last week kind of bears talking about it. I mean, one, we're a month away from the election. And I do think there's a significant impact to this, and that's a little bit different. I mean, I guess to a certain degree, it's the same stakes as 4 years ago, just with a different opposition on the Democratic side. But I do feel like we've reached some kind of tipping point that things don't go a certain way, it could get way bad. So anyway, with that said, I think just with the flurry of news, I mean, you have Ruth Bader Ginsburg passing away in the fight over the Supreme Court. You have Trump's taxes finally getting released, and turns out, you know, he doesn't pay taxes, and all his businesses have lost like $1 billion for X amount of time. And then you have the debate, which was a debacle, mostly caused by the president and his methodology of just kind of, I don't know, thrash, you know, slash and burn and fire and fury and just get angry. And, you know, his methodology was to interrupt and mess with Biden so much that it would throw him off because he has a stuttering problem. And that was part of the strategy. And it was just ugly, you know, what I equated to is like, you remember when you were a kid, and like your brother or sister would hit you, and then you would hit back, but they would only catch you hitting back. And then they would be like, both of you just shut the hell up and be good, or I'll punish you both. But they did it first, but you only get caught on the hit back. That's what I describe that debate. And what actually Trump is very successful at is basically starting the problem. And then when you retaliate, then it looks like everyone's screwing up, you know, and all the you know, and like I said, I couldn't tell you who quote unquote won or came across better to undecided voters. It seemed like Trump did worse, but I can't really speculate too much on that. And I think people tend to see what they want to see. If you are a supporter of him, then you think he did great. If you hate him, you think he did terrible. You know, I think the moment, you know, about whether he would denounce white supremacy was the thing people probably going to remember the most. Proud Boys, you know, stand back and stand by. you know, but keep in mind, that's already kind of baked in, I think, with him. It's funny, Scott Adams, who writes Dilbert, a comic who is a big Trump booster, like, denounced the president, said he wasn't going to vote for him. And then I guess liberals were like donkey on him. So then he decided he was going to vote for him. It's kind of hilarious. But because of that, And even I saw this show, The Circus, on Showtime, and Steve Bannon was watching the show. And even that moment, you could tell he kind of couldn't believe what happened. But anyway, so at that moment, then Trump gets COVID and like half his White House. It's insane. The first lady, even today, they announced his press secretary got it, two of the cleaning staff got it. I mean, this is a real disaster. And at every step, he's handling it worse and worse and worse. They lied about his doctors come out on TV and lie every day about his condition. They contradict. The doctors gave a certain public pronouncement about how well he was doing. And then the chief of staff, Mark Meadows, gave a off the record gaggle and said that no, he was actually doing really bad. And everything's about PR. You know, he goes out and gives this ride along just to like, and it's total kind of dictator 101, which is I'm the strong man and I can never be weak. And look at how I'm killing it. It's like this idea, you know, like Putin like wrestles bears and, you know, and Kim Jong-un, you know, he plays golf and he, you know, does, you know, when he has some insane score that no one has ever done. And, you know, it's this kind of, I don't know, blind myth making that for some reason is very appealing to some people. And I will personally never understand it, even though it's clearly something that human beings en masse are susceptible to. But it's a real just ugly, scary moment. And I don't know, there's this, like I said, I'm not going to belabor this too much, but this idea that's kind of been around of like, should you, because, you know, I posted some shit, you know, just laughing, you know, because I do think it's funny that he got it, because at every step of the way, he's handled this terribly. He said it was going to go away. He downplayed it. They dismantled the CDC. He did not, you know, he waited 4 or 5 months before wearing a mask in public. And you can find countless videos of him basically saying that he doesn't think people should wear masks, or if they don't want to, they shouldn't have to. It's really bad. And, you know, he undermines testing, saying the more we test, the more people will have it. I mean, really blown it in just about every way. And so to me, it's, do I want the president to die from COVID? No. Do I want any of his staff or his wife to die from it? No. But do I think getting it, and it's a funny thing, I don't think it's karma. I think it's just a literal carelessness. I really think he thinks that he's immune to these things, or that it doesn't, that happens to other people, not to me, you know, maybe he really is a conspiracy theorist. Like, oh, it's a hoax. And so they just didn't take it that seriously, you know? And this idea that, he's getting the best medical care any human being can basically get. And he's having real problems, but he's projecting the idea that he's doing fine. And I think he'll be fine, you know, but they just won't publicize what he really went through. He'll never be honest about that to the public, you know? But the truth is, if he was just a regular, you know, guy owned a hardware store who was 74 years old and his weight and with his diet and all that stuff, I think he'd be in real trouble, you know, because usually people don't go to the hospital until the last, you know, till they like really have. I mean, some of the hospitals tell you, listen, unless you're like can't breathe, don't come to the hospital. And he went, you know, I was just thinking, I was like, what disease do you get on like a Thursday and by Saturday you have to go to a hospital? I mean, diseases generally aren't like that. You know, cancer and AIDS, these things take months or years to develop. That's insane. That's how, you know, to me, and then when you see how fast it spread throughout the White House, it gives you an idea of how contagious this thing is. Like, it's contagious, insanely, and if you get it, like I said, he's on this crazy Remdesivir, I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. It's, you know, it's not even approved by the FDA, but apparently it's you know, a very strong treatment. program and, you know, this crazy steroid that helps you with, you know, your blood oxygen levels that apparently you don't take that unless you're doing pretty rough. So, you know, he has all these advantages, but then he'll use that as like some proof of like that it's not that dangerous that you can get through. It's like, yeah, but we don't get to go to the hospital like preventatively. We don't get, you know, a team of doctors. We don't get all these medications that maybe are not available to everyone. I'm not totally sure about all of them, but I don't know. It's a real, this is the idea. Like, should you feel bad? I mean, I think you can say, you know, you can't say the president is at, you know, it's his fault of the coronavirus. Of course not. I mean, I think no matter who was in charge, this thing was going to happen. But I do think you can put a certain amount of loss of life, or even I would say if there'd been some kind of national plan, whether that was, you know, making masks mandatory in public places nationally, or at least some just leadership saying, hey, this is something we should worry about. I think we would have gotten ahead of it, and everything would have happened better, quicker. And you can put a life count on that. So if someone, instead of 200,000 people dead and there were 100,000 people were dead because things were taken more seriously, and if that's literally your fault, and people say, oh, Zari's, no, he's in charge. I do think there's a body count on that. And if that's real, doesn't mean I wish you dead, but I can at least fucking laugh at you. That's all. By the way, I'm sorry. That's what I get to do. Right, and I'm not a death penalty guy. I'm not a vengeance guy. It's not about that. It's about him, at least for 1 minute, getting to feel the pain that other people have to go through. You know, he's a bad guy, and ultimately, I'll say this, and I really believe that. I think he's a bad guy. I think he went out there. The things he's doing is putting people in danger. And listen, I hope this shit opens up. We can figure this out. But the funny thing is, everyone wore a mask and did all shit. Shit could open up. We could do things if everyone actually just did all the stuff. That's the thing, is not doing it extends the problem. And like I said, where we're looking right now, I think nothing's going to change until there's a vaccine, you know, which hopefully will be sooner than later. And then even with that, how many people aren't going to take it for whatever reason, you know? And like I said, and with all that said, I'm not saying Biden's a great candidate, or that he's going to be a particularly great president. I don't know all that. I don't think he's a great candidate. I'm not that optimistic he's going to be a great president. But I do think he's a better person. And I do think he actually gives a shit, despite all his failings. Like, the guy says dumb shit all the time that are gaffes. I think he makes mistakes in the moment. I think he apologizes. And he's, oh, I didn't mean to say that. And I really don't think he did. You know, all the time. And I do think he is too old to be president, and I do think he's not as sharp as he once was. But it's so vastly better than what we have now. And everything, and some things are bridged to somewhere else. And we'll see what that's going to be, you know? But I'll say this, that's my opinion. I would never tell anybody what to do. Just go out and vote, exercise your right. I was saying this, I just got my ballot in the mail, and I was like, you know how you know voting is important, or that your vote's important, is that look at how hard they're trying to get your vote, and look at how hard other people are trying to stop you from voting. That's how you know it's important. So, you know, like one of my heroes, George Carlin, says he doesn't vote, and he's like, yeah, if you don't vote, you know, only people vote have reason. I forget how he said it, but George, I'm sorry. I love him, but he was an oracle. He was wrong about some things, and he's wrong on that. I get it. It's not much. It's a drop in the bucket. But at least for, you know, my case, people died for people like me to be able to vote. So I'm going to do it. It makes me feel good, and I think it's important. But all right. Well, that was a long one. We have no sponsors this week. But this is a very special episode, because my father is the guest on this show. And, you know, I talk about it a little bit in the intro with him about, you know, how I really wanted to get my mother on the show, and I was able to do that. And so this is about not really, you know, or about having regrets in your life. And you know, I can't get that back. I can't get that time to have my mother and show and have her tell her story or put together, you know, and which kind of goes to a deeper meaning of what doing something like this even means, because it's just to have a archive. You know, and I'm probably going to talk to a lot of my family members. I don't know if I'll put all the shows out, but just for my own personal kind of curiosity, you know, because if you don't get some of that history and someone passed away, then it's gone. You know, and so, you know, I don't know, it makes me kind of think about all that stuff. And, you know, you can't wait. Anyway, I feel like I'm meandering a little bit. But anyway, I was really happy to get my father on. He's a bad motherfucker, as he would say, very influential to my life. And, you know, someone who I think would be that I think you guys would find interesting to talk to or listen to. I talk to him. You're listening. Anyway, this is like a very, very loose, very loose intro here, but that's okay. I'm feeling a little emotional and I apologize. But anyway, let's talk to my dad, right? You guys want to hear from the talented and also handsome. You know, I have a lot of handsome people on the show, and I gotta compliment them. That's where I got the genes from. Anyway, check out this conversation with my dad. I love my dad. Check it out, Mr. Kevin Coyle. Welcome to the X-Man podcast. You know, I was supposed to, you know, I wanted to talk to mom, you know, before she passed away and have both you guys on the show. You know, but I was like, and I was thinking about it, because I was like, you know, if I like did a show with you and then put it out, but it was like before I put it out with her, like she would be mad, yeah, you know?
Yeah, but now, unfortunately, you're stuck with me.
Yeah. Well, I was like, I need to get my dad before he fucking croaks, or else I'm going to like...
Yeah, it's like, oh, hey, man, get that motherfucker on. You know what I mean?
So, yeah. You know, because this is, you know, I think it's important, you know, like, you know, I think as you get older, you start to think about legacy, I guess, and kind of how we got here. And, you know, we talk a lot about stuff, but it's sometimes you just don't really dig into some of the details. So a lot of this is almost satisfying my own curiosity, because I do think you're an interesting motherfucker, so to speak. But you know,
well, you know what? Like with me, like you know, I always keep up with the older relatives. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I learned that from Allen Ginsberg, and this goes back to like, I don't know, 1984. Allen Ginsberg said, you know what? He says you got to talk to your older relatives. You know. And he used to always go visit them in the hospital. And I said to myself, and that's where I got that idea. I said, you know, and I still, I mean, like my uncles are in the 80s, you know what I mean? So I still talk to them, you know? So it's an important thing to do. And I'm not that old yet, you know, but I might get there, you know? So.
Yeah, well, you know, you're doing good. So I want to ask you, a little bit about your childhood to start. So our family, your side of the family, like they used to live in Jersey City, right? So were you born in like Jersey City?
I was born in Jersey City, yes, at the medical center, yes.
And then you moved to Carteret and then Edison, or how did that?
Yes, because when I was 5 years old, we moved to Carteret. I went to school in Carteret until I was 10 years old in fifth grade. Then we moved to Edison, and then that's where I went to high school and stuff. And then after that, I went to Kane College. So, yeah. I mean, that's where I got my teaching degree.
So, you know, so mainly you grew up in Central Jersey, you know, that was your upbringing.
Well, more. I mean, that Jersey City thing was a big thing.
So, you know? But you were up until 5 years old, though.
We used to go visit our relatives in Jersey City until I was, you know, 15, 16 years old.
Yeah.
So we were constantly in Jersey City, and that was a big, you know, immigration place for the Irish, you know, the German, and the the Polish.
I mean, so our family, my grandfather, your father was Irish, and my grandmother was Polish, and what?
Well, actually, I mean, it's a weird family, yeah, because, you know, the Coyles are Irish, you know, the your great-grandmother Balbian was Polish, but then the Balbian family is originally from Armenia, and then they emigrated. This is a long story. Then they emigrated to the Netherlands in the 1600s, and then they emigrated to Germany in the 1700s.
So it's a real, they're like, what are they, gypsies or something?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's like, you know, it's like, I mean, but that's just the way the family worked. But they all, like, you know, hooked up in the downtown in Jersey City, which is where all the, you know, the immigrants, you know, just went. That's where they lived.
So, I mean, but just for you personally and the family identity and kind of culturally, was it, did you just feel like a normal, like, Irish Catholic kind of American family? Was that the vibe?
No, because, you know, see, because we were raised Catholic, but then we were Irish Catholic, but then Polish Catholic.
Yeah.
So it's two different things.
But you were still connecting to both kind of heritage.
Yeah, well, that religious thing, yeah, with the whole Catholic thing, yeah. And I went to Catholic school. I got spanked my first day in kindergarten class. So, I mean, that kind of, like, you know, described my whole, education career.
You were self, well, you, like, as you told me one day, said, Doc, you know, I think I'm a radical. Maybe you always were a radical.
No, it's like Sister Mary Ursula, man. She said, come here, you. Smack, smack, smack. You know? So that was it. You know what I mean? I mean, that started my school career. And it pretty much didn't change. Other than that, that was pretty much my whole career. Except though I lucked out with really good teachers, though. So I
yeah. Well, you're the oldest of four boys. And, I mean, was there a particular burden about being the oldest in terms of kind of, you know, you're like the experimental?
Yeah, because you're the experiment.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, like, no, they didn't. No, the same stuff that they did to me, they didn't do to my younger brothers.
Yeah.
You know, your Uncle David and Brian, they didn't do that stuff to them. They just said, oh, yeah. It's like,
what kind of stuff?
Oh, just disciplinary stuff and all that stuff.
So they whooped your ass, but they didn't whip their ass?
Nah, it wasn't that. It was just like restrictions and stuff. My parents were never big on the, physical discipline. They were never big on that stuff, so.
Yeah. But some of this I kind of feel like I already know, did you have a general camaraderie with your brothers? You were close to them?
Oh yeah, well, me and Chris especially, and then, you know, with David too, because your Uncle David was a drummer.
Yeah.
You know? So the thing was that, like, you know, growing up in Edison, you know, the whole musical thing in Edison, I mean, I was studying jazz, I mean, that area. You know, I was studying piano, and that whole area was a jazz area, but you had George Clinton there.
Yeah.
You know, Parliament Funkadelic. So, I mean, there was this whole, like, music scene there of jazz and funk. And, you know, I mean, that was just kind of the thing. I mean, like, I mean, it was just, you know, I mean, the Isley Brothers. I mean, all that stuff was real big, you know, when, you know, and then a lot of that stuff, my brothers, I developed a jazz interest, but my brothers, especially Uncle David, was into the funk scene.
Well, let's talk about that real quick. So you're a piano player, but when do you actually start? Did you start, like, taking lessons traditionally when you were younger?
Yeah, I had this teacher. You know what? I first started playing trumpet.
Uh-huh. How old?
Fifth grade, I think. I think I was in fifth grade. And then I did that for a couple years, but the teacher, I didn't get along with the teacher, and then I quit. But then once I discovered the piano player Joe Zawinul with the Cannonball Adderley quintet, I mean, that, you know, changed, you know, my focus as far as music goes, because I became this jazz guy. And like, no, we were like, you know, we wanted to play like Joe Zawinul. But the thing, though, is, I mean, I started studying, and then my teacher and I both like Thelonious Monk, and it just hit off right away.
Well, let me ask a question. This is the mid '60s, right? And probably mid '60s to late to early '70s, right? When you're kind of coming up, and I would feel like a lot of your peers are, you know, listening to fucking Foghat and Led Zeppelin, and you know, So what was it about you? Like, why are you discovering this kind of other kind of more left of center art music scene that, you know, was a little different than some of the kind of kids you grew up with.
I'll be honest with you. Like, the first time, there's a song called Mercy, Mercy, Mercy by Joe Zawinul and Cannibal Adderley, which I heard on the school bus when I was in, like, seventh grade. Mm-hmm. And I said, this is the greatest song in the world. And I just got hooked on to jazz. And then they used to have this radio station called WRVR, and I started listening to it when I was 14 years old. And I started, like, you know, just, you know, getting into it. And I got into, like, you know, the Harlan piano. It's like I've had a lot of associations with interesting musicians when I was 14, 15, 16 years old. I mean, it's very, very interesting, you know, history as far as I have of meeting these, like, older musicians. And I'm talking about people born 1900 who were, like, you know, Harlan piano players who kind of, like, you know, used to talk to me about stuff, and I'm going, like, oh, you got to check out Fats Waller, you know, got to do this stuff. And, like, no, of course, I mean, I'm not sure anybody, you know, knows too much about Fats Waller, but I certainly do, and I certainly did when I was 14.
But, I mean, but did you have any of your fellow teenagers or your brothers or anyone immediate family also into this or encouraging this, or is this kind of your, like, lone mission?
No, your Uncle David could play drums like Stevie Wonder.
Yeah, really?
You know, yeah. No, he was really good playing drums. And he had big ears. Like, he liked the Isley Brothers, but he's the one who discovered Harlan Funkadelic. And with me, though, like, I was a jazz guy. And, you know, I mean, like, with the Miles Davis stuff, because I kind of went from, you know, I discovered the jazz stuff, but originally I was a Jimi Hendrix guy.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, it's ridiculous.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, Jimi Hendrix is closer to the Led Zeppelin kind of end of things than he is.
Nah. Like, Hendrix's band, the Gypsies, changed everything.
Yeah.
You know, that Buddy Miles and Billy Cox thing. I mean, he got rid of, like, you know, the original Hendrix experience and went with that. Eventually, he got, like, you know, Mitch Mitchell back in the band. But the thing, though, is that, I mean, that... when that came out, it was unbelievable. It's like Hendrix, I mean, that changed everybody. Even Miles Davis, when he heard Machine Gun, said that changed everything, you know? So, I mean, that was kind of revolutionary at the time. And then, and after that, though, that's when I got into the electric Miles Davis stuff, Bitches Brew and all that stuff.
At this point, were your parents supportive of kind of like this kind of counterculture you were kind of delving into, or would they
but my father, let me tell you something, man. I was raised on Nat King Cole, Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin, Sammy Davis Jr., Bing Crosby, you know, yeah. I mean, some Louis Armstrong stuff, you know, like Hello Dolly and all that stuff. But my parents listened to, like, I mean, we listened to, like, you know, Nat King Cole singing Mona Lisa.
What's that considered? Kind of like big band, kind of balladeer stuff?
Actually, my mother was a piano player when she was a kid, but she had a really good jazz collection, and she used to listen to jazz when she was a kid. But, you know, I mean, but the thing was that it was more, you know, the pop radio that we listened to at the time was more, you know, the Frank Sinatra, Bing Crosby stuff.
Yeah. But I guess what I mean is, I mean, ultimately, music, piano, jazz, you know, even, you know, some of the, you know, kind of more obscure classical stuff you got into became like a career path. But was that something that you were kind of expressing as a teenager? Like, hey, this is something I don't just like it. Like, I really like it. And this is something I want to be my life to be about.
No, because you know what? I never thought about, like, when I was 17, 18 years old, I never thought about being a professional piano player. Now, the other thing, too, what I want to say is when I was in high school, I was the only person listening to jazz. You know, nobody my age was listening to jazz, Thelonious Monk, you know, any of that stuff. And, you know, they were all, like, you know, that usual, like, no rock and roll stuff. And I realized when I was, like, 17 or 18, I said, I'm not going to make a living out of this. And that's when I went to school to become a teacher, you know?
Yeah, but you were, hold on, before that, but you were also a big Beatles fan. So some,
We all were. We all were. It's like everybody.
But but Beatles is kind of part of the, I guess, mainstream rock and roll kind of tapestry. So there was some kind of more mainstream rock bands that you did enjoy of that era.
Oh, yeah, no. I mean, the thing though is that, when I was a kid, I might have said this before, but I liked the Smothers Brothers and Donovan. I mean, like, all this ridiculous stuff that, you wouldn't think, this guy went from Smothers Brothers to Miles Davis. How'd he get there? You know what I mean? But the thing was that, that's what I did. The thing was that it was when we were young kids, it's like our parents listened to this certain sort of music, and that's what you listen to, Yeah. But the thing was that it was just a development out of that. And, I guess the family had big ears as far as it went, as far as music goes, especially my father. My father was a big Sinatra guy,
Yeah, I know that from, spending time over their house, Pop-Pop would, get a few Bud Lights in him, and he just listened to Sinatra, and he was in his zone.
Yeah, but that was it, though. You don't understand, they took us to Frank Sinatra movies at the drive-in, it was Frank Sinatra, even Nat King Cole. I mean, we went to see Nat King Cole stuff in the movies. He was in, Cap Blue, and he used to be singing Cap Blue, and he was, he was kicking it. I mean, it was kind of interesting, times, but I'm, 9 years old, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I have a lot of appreciation for that stuff. I mean, Sinatra to me is, he might be, for me, just the best tone, timbre, the best tonal voice for me, I've heard.
Yeah, no, I mean, to me,
and that's Jersey shit. That's a Jersey City motherfucker right there. Well, actually, where is he from? Hoboken? Hoboken. Yeah.
But the thing, though, I mean, Miles Davis's two favorite singers are Frank Sinatra and Willie Nelson. And he used to listen to them just for phrasing.
Yeah.
But Frank Sinatra, though, I mean, Willie Nelson is really good. Willie Nelson has got this feel for, rhythm. But Frank Sinatra has got pipes like an opera singer.
Yeah.
But he swings.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He swings, and he's not really a jazz guy, but the guy's doing it. It was just the whole, thing with that time period. It was just the way it is. I mean, movies and, TV and, records and stuff, he kind of dominated.
Yeah, he was kind of the proto-crossover kind of pop star of his day. He kind of set that step. Before Elvis, before that, he was, the guy, right? Bing Crosby, you was, song and dance man, kind of jack of all trades.
No. Well, the thing, though, and the thing about this is in pop music, and my piano tuner, George Owens, who's the one who turned me out to Harlem piano music, explained to me. He said, he said, in 1930, there was Bing Crosby. Bing Crosby was the biggest pop star. But he said when Sinatra hit, it was all over.
Yeah.
Sinatra was the guy. And my mother was a Bobby Soxer.
What does that mean?
That they were the groupies for Frank Sinatra. They used to go see Frank Sinatra perform in New York City or wherever he was performing. And she was like 13, 14 years old. You never heard Bobby Soxer?
I mean, I've heard the term, but I'm sure, probably from you.
Yeah, but Bobby Soxer, I mean, it's just these 13, 14 year old girls who loved, and her and her, my Aunt Rosemary used to go to Jersey City, but the thing was that they used to go see, Duke Ellington, Louis Armstrong. They used to see all the band, Count Basie. They used to see all the bands in Jersey City on Sundays, because it was a full show. It's they went to church. They went to Polish church in the morning at 8 o'clock. They get out at 9. Then they took the train to Jersey City and they watched bands all day long.
Yeah. Well, that's, so, there's something there in the blood a little bit.
My family on the German side, they go back a long way with music, and so did the Irish too.
That's awesome.
But the Polish too, because my grandmother, your great grandmother Balbian, was a great, she used to sing in church. She was like in in a church choir. So it's like that stuff kind of runs in the family.
So clearly there's a, you know, kind of a through line here that a lot of the stuff you were interested in artistically, culturally, was really Black music and Black culture and Black history. It seemed to be something you kind of were drawn to and connected with. I mean, do you really, like, where do you think that stems from, or what is it about, you know, kind of culturally, or just that you feel more akin with that music and that what's going on there?
I mean, it was just, like I said, once I heard Mercy, 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 you know, I said to myself, I got to play piano like that, you know. But there was a white guy, Joe Zawinul, you know, but he was playing, you know, African-American music, and he was one of the best at it, you know. And I said to myself, you know, I mean, so this guy, and like my piano teacher, Bill Biddle, when I was like, you know, 16, 17 years old, loved Joe Zawinul. It's like, no, I was lucky. I just hit it off with people who had my common interests, you know?
Yeah.
And it's the same thing too. It's like, you know, people today, if you heard, say, Fats Waller, you know, you wouldn't necessarily say that's Black music. But at the time, it was Black music, you know what I mean?
I mean, did you grow up with Black kids in your school at all or anything like that? Or was it mostly white?
Not until I got to Edison.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So when was New Jersey like segregated at one point and then it became integrated, or?
No, because we lived in Carteret, but you know, I mean, there was a sort of redlining there because it was a Catholic neighborhood. Like they pushed all like the Protestants in one neighborhood and there weren't too many Black people there, but the thing was that we were in a Catholic neighborhood. It was all Catholic. It was Irish Catholic, Polish Catholic, Puerto Rican Catholic, Italian Catholic, you know what I mean? But it was all Catholic. We all went to a Catholic school, went to Catholic church. And that's the way the neighborhood was. And then, like, when I started playing baseball when I was 9 years old, that's the first time I met Protestant kids. Mm-hmm. That's the first time I ever met Protestant kids. But there were no Black kids in Carteret, not until I got to Edison in the junior high school in fifth grade. Edison was integrated, you know. So in Catholic, like, no, in Carteret, it wasn't.
Yeah. So as you're kind of getting into like high school age, you know, and graduating high school, you know, there's kind of a lot going on because you have essentially the tail end of the Vietnam War, right? You know, kind of, you know, you could say, you know, what's kind, you know. Basically, got after 68, you know, you got RFK gets killed. You know, this is, you know, a kind of fraught time period for the country. But you're kind of like at this age where maybe you don't have to confront it as directly if you were maybe five or six years older.
No, that's not true because I had a draft number during the Vietnam War.
No, I know, but it wasn't like you were 21 in 1968. You understand what I'm saying? Like you weren't. You know, like it, you were just young enough where it was, you were there for it, but it wasn't necessarily like, you know, did you go to like anti-Vietnam marches or things like that or protests?
No, but the thing though was that, like, say when I was a sophomore and junior in high school, you know, we had to write papers about the Vietnam War, what we thought about it.
What did you feel about it?
I was conflicted. I wasn't sure if the war should go on or if it shouldn't. But the thing, though, I will say this, though. Once I got my draft number, I said, friends of mine in my class, because I graduated in 72, and, you know, I'll be honest with you. If I had the same, if I was born a year earlier, they would have sent me to Vietnam in combat, okay? But the thing was that friends of mine in high school, their older brothers served in Vietnam, you know, and it was bad. It was real bad.
So how many friends, I mean, did you have a fair amount of friends that went to Vietnam?
They served in the military and they came back with PTSDs, and one of my friends, his brother, you know, just broke down in basic training, you know.
Yeah.
They sent him home with a nervous breakdown. So, yeah, I mean, it was bad. I mean, and the other thing, too, when I was in college, I hung around with a lot of Vietnam vets because they were in my classes. And they were like, I was 18, 19, and they were 23, 24 years old. So, but they used to talk to me about what happened there, and it was not good. You know, I mean, we were aware of things, and I mean, a lot of people weren't aware of things with that, you know?
Mm-hmm. Did, you know, I mean, because obviously, you know, when it comes to a war, and I think that time period, you know, when you're late teenager, kind of getting into your early 20s is when, you know, people start to kind of formulate their political ideology and kind of framework. I mean, you know, from what I've grown up with you, you know, you've been pretty lefty, you know.
Yeah. No, our family is, you know, Franklin Roosevelt, Kennedy, Democrats. And when I was 18, I voted for George McGovern. Yeah. You know, he lost by a landslide.
And I just looked it up. 60%. He got 40% of the vote, lost 49 states.
Yeah. Like he got like, no, but the thing was that Nixon got impeached, you know? So, I mean, things happen, but you know, yeah, I mean, but yeah, but we're definitely like, you know, that, you know, Jersey City Democrat. I mean, I'm still that way. I'm still like a Roosevelt Kennedy guy, Bobby Kennedy mostly, you know?
Yeah.
And no, I mean, I can, you know, I mean, it's just a way of thinking. There's no way I'm going to be voting for Trump. I mean, no doubt about that.
But what I'm saying, but do you think that for you, your ideology really is informed by your family background and kind of how you came up?
No, it is. Yeah. No, it is. I mean, because that whole Polish and Irish background, it comes out of that ward system where, you know, I mean, they're delivering, like, you know, if there's a widow in a neighborhood who doesn't have coal, you know, they're delivering coal to keep that family warm in Jersey City. And I mean, you have to remember, my great grandmother, Sheehy, was a widow. You know, and they gave her a job cleaning the floor at the Jersey City Library. That's how she made her living. And she supported five children on that, you know, after her husband passed away.
But our family was, you know, from what I gather, you know, very kind of working class, union oriented kind of industry. I mean, Pop, you know, he worked in a factory. And then,
you know, I mean, the thing though about that is that, you know, your great great grandfather, Kevin Coyle, and also on the Polish side, they worked at the sugar factory in Jersey City. And he was a sugar weigher. That was a big job. If you could weigh sugar back in 1900, it was a big deal. But my grandfather, Coyle, who's your great grandfather, was a designer for Western Electric. And he was actually allowed into the war room at Western Electric during World War II. He was designing weapons for the military, you know? And same thing with my father. My father was a designer for pocketbooks and stuff when he got his job at the factory. And these guys were all like skilled with drawing and stuff. So it's kind of fascinating how the family kind of works that way, you know?
Yeah. So, you know, you eventually go to college, Kane College, to pursue a degree in education. Right. As long as I've known you, you've, you know, kind of fancied yourself an intellectual. You're someone who, you're probably the most well-read person I've ever known. You know, you've always, that might just mean I don't know a lot of well-read people. So don't take it, don't break your arm.
I won't take it personally.
but what I'm saying is you're someone who, you know, despite having, you know, formal education, also seems to really believe in the creed of self-education.
Right, yeah.
And continual education, right? Like the idea that education never ends, right?
Right, yeah.
And so that's something, you know, that I do feel like, you know, I had the benefit of, you know, kind of going to advanced classes. You know, Dallas and I both, you know, when we were in grade school, the gifted and talented classes, and getting probably a better education than some of the other kids at our same school. And then had the advantage of going to a pretty high-end private school for the last 3 years of high school, which was extremely challenging and a much better education and eye-opening experience I would have gotten otherwise if I'd have stayed in New Brunswick. But I think really the real seeds of my kind of intellectual curiosity really stem from being inspired by you, because, you know, we'd be at home and maybe at some other person's house, they'd be watching Johnny Carson, but we'd be watching like documentaries on like the Holocaust, and, you know, we'd be, you know, it was always, you know, you went out of your way to kind of give me, to steep me and, I can't really speak for Dallas, but, you know, steep me in his historical context and kind of say, you know, hey, this is what was going on with the slave trade. Hey, here's what was going on with the founders. You know, so, I mean, was that your mindset even before you went to college, or is that something you kind of discovered along the way of someone who's being interested in history and kind of, you know, political, you know, the kind of the big picture of it?
That's a good question. It's like, I don't consider myself a smart person, except, I don't know. But the thing though is that, like, I have just a curious intellect, you know, because I ping pong, you know. It's like I'm reading this book about this woman named Dolores Ibadari, who's like, and I just read this book by the Spanish author, this fiction book, and her name was in there, and I just found her name. Now I'm reading the book. So, like, I just ping-pong back and forth between, like, you know, what kind of interests me. So that turns me on to something else. And then I read, you know, something about the bullfighter Manolete, who's considered, like, you know, the greatest bullfighter in the world. It's like, I'll be like, how do you find this stuff out? You know what I mean? And I just know this stuff, but a lot of it's probably just useless information. But I just go back and forth going, like, this is interesting. You know what I mean? So,
well, you know what's funny about knowledge? Knowledge is a lot like money. Can't take it with you to the grave.
Right. Yeah. But the thing is that, like, you know, like with me, you know, it's like I'm a piano teacher, but I can teach people how to play piano, and they're going to outlive me.
Yeah. Well, yeah, of course. There is a, you know, a legacy element to passing down knowledge and passing down money for that. And I can't wait for the coil fortune when it comes my way. I'm really, if I live.
Hey, listen, if you get it, you let me know.
Okay. Well, I'll definitely have a lot of sheet music. I'll say that.
You know what? That's true. It's like, I mean, it's like there was sheet music and then a few books and some CDs. I don't know if CDs are going to be running around too much longer. So
you graduate college, and this was at a time. So you went to college fairly cheaply, right? Like you.
Yeah. I mean, my father lost his job, so we got financial aid. So I didn't have to pay that much. But the thing that was that during when I was in college, I worked my last 2 years in college. I worked full time and went to college.
This is where you're working at the pharmacy?
Yeah, at the pharmacy. Yeah, I became a pharmacist assistant. And my last year, I was working 40 hours at the pharmacy, and I was going to school full time.
Yeah, so guys, so he used to work in this pharmacy. I like how I'm telling your story, but and this legendary guy, Saul, owned the place. And it's only until I got older that my father, my Uncle Dave, rest in peace, started telling me these stories, how they were stealing medical grade cocaine.
wait. Well, actually, no, I guess the statute of limitations is off, but you know what?
Was that no one's coming for you, and this is good content for the podcast, right? This just bugs me out, because you had this idea of your parents and your relatives and adults that they're just like good standing, you know, just like they have their shit together, and then you realize, and you grow up, and they finally feel comfortable enough to tell you all the crazy shit they did. And you're like, oh no, they're fuck ups just like us. And it's not a, but not in a bad way. It's actually more, it's just illuminating that we're all just like, we all just like to have fun.
We're all human beings.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, I mean, yeah, those times were interesting times. And I can't say we didn't have fun.
So by the way, I gotta cut you off, but Uncle Dave, all right, when he was talking, this guy would talk about this medical grade cocaine like an old girlfriend that was like the hottest girl he ever was with. He was like, you could see the joy. He's like, Doc, you cannot believe how good this cocaine was. I'm like, what world am I living? This is the funniest thing I've ever heard in my life, you know? And I'm like,
you know what? I mean,
I guess back in the day when you could get prescription cocaine for like anesthetic and things like that.
No, they only used cocaine for eye operations.
That's what I said, for anesthetic.
Yeah. For eye operations.
Because there's the numbing agent. Right.
Yeah. So they could do the operation. But the thing though is that, you know, I mean, I'm not going to go into what we did here.
You know? You don't want it on the record? Well, you better put it in a book or something.
It'll be in a book. They're going to have to buy the book. I mean, I'm going to put all the stuff up here. But, you know, I mean, those were interesting times, and they continue to be interesting after that. I mean, it's just the way things were back then. You know, I mean, it's like all the mothers were like on amphetamines and, you know,
diet pills.
Diet pills and downers. I mean, that's in the 60s. I mean, all the mothers were on that stuff, you know. The doctors used to give them diet pills during the day. Then they give them barbiturates at night to go to sleep. And that's the way it was, you know.
Suburban bliss.
Yep, that's what it was. It was, you know what? It was like a John Cassavetes movie.
Yeah.
That's the way it was, you know. So, but that was, you know, just the way things ran back then, you know.
So...
I'll tell you this, there were a lot of casualties. A lot of people I know either OD'd or committed suicide or stuff because of drugs. So, I mean, it's not, you know, all you're like, you know, whatever.
So when does grandma kick you out of the house?
When I met your mother.
Really? Okay. So this is good, because I was going to ask you about that. So my late mother, may she rest in peace. You met her when you were how old?
I guess late 1976, 1977.
Okay, so you're 20. So you're 22, 23.
Yeah.
So just out of college.
Yeah, but I was playing in bands though. It's interesting because when I got out of college with my teaching degree, you couldn't buy a teaching job.
Yeah.
You know? So I started doing different work, but then I started playing with bands, and I was working with Wes, with Sabrina's Energy.
So tell the people about Wes so they understand what you're talking about.
Wes is this fantastic bass player. He lives in Hungary now. Wes Brinson, he's on
Bassman Wes. He's like a 6'3" black dude who's hilarious. And probably, yeah. I imagine in 75 was probably had a great big afro too.
Yep. And the thing though, well, back then I had like, you know, I looked like, you know, I had long hair and I had a big beard and stuff.
Okay, so guys, I'm gonna tell you what my dad used to look like. All right, have you ever seen Almost Famous? He looked like Russell, Billy Crudup's character, you know, the lead guy. Like, there's, I mean, this is so, but that would just be with the mustache, because there were I've seen pictures with the mustache. And I haven't really seen so many pictures with the full beard, but.
Yeah, well, I mean, Wes has got him. But Wes, though, when he was 17, he dropped out of high school to play with Junior Walker and the All-Stars. Now, Junior Walker is in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And then Wes came back to New Brunswick to get his college, his high school degree. But then he played with Kevin Goins from Harlem and Funkadelic. And Kevin Goins is in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame too. But he died young. Like, Kevin Goins was my age, and he died when he was 24 from Hodgkin's disease. You know? So the thing was that, like, a lot of that stuff in that time period, I mean, it's not all like, you know, peaches and cream. But the thing though is that, like, you know, Wes played with these people, famous people. Then I started playing with Wes, and we did gigs up until about 1979. But the thing was that,
so what so was this like with one band or multiple bands?
And multiple
what kind of
bands.
What kind of music is it?
Well, me and Wes, originally we were doing funk, Evelyn Champagne King stuff. I'm not sure if you ever heard of her. But like, no, Sabrina, this woman, Sabrina, was one of the best singers I've ever worked. And again, I mean, she died young of a stroke. I mean, she was only like 24, 25 years old. But the thing though is that we were doing stuff like that. We were doing like mostly funk stuff. And then with the band with your mother, that was more of trying to be like a pop crossover, which is when I started working with your mother. But
how did you meet her?
With that, I guess, with that band. I mean, through Kevin Michaels or Wes. I mean, she saw me first play with Sabrina's Energy with Wes.
Okay. So you basically guys were, was it her band? Was it, whose band was it that you started playing together with?
I don't know. I mean, I guess I was the nominal leader, but I'm not a big general or nothing.
I'm not the colonel of the army,
you know, so to me.
So my mom in the, you know, in the mid-70s, something we would describe as a dime piece. All right. My mom was pretty hot. Okay.
Oh yeah.
And at this point, had you ever dated any black women before?
Yes, once.
Once. Okay. And you know, and so you're kind of, you know, at one point you were interested in black music, black culture. That's something you identified with. But now you're kind of like in this world of music and multiracial bands, and you're kind of more immersed. You know what I'm saying? You're actually, you know, which I imagine, you know, the people you came up with in your family, they weren't living that lifestyle and kind of being involved in these circles. I mean, I don't even know what the fucking question I'm asking here is, but
Well, you know what? You know, let me put it this way. When you're the only white person in a room, it's interesting.
Did you like it? Did you like being the token white guy? Did you feel good? Did you feel accepted?
I didn't have a choice. Like, I was the white guy. Like, I was a white guy playing piano, you know, and that was it. You know, I was in the room with everybody, and I'm like, that's it, you know. And the thing that was, I mean, it ran that way for like a couple of years, and then like, no, we started playing with Jack Yoakam and stuff, you know, and in the band with Jack. But you know, I mean, your mother had a certain style of music that she sang that they didn't want to do, and you know, I always like, you know, with mother and stuff, I always thought her strength was, you know, that R&B jazz stuff, you know, like Billy, like she could do Billie Holiday. I mean, she could do Betty Carter. She could really sing stuff. But a lot of people didn't like that style, and it wasn't a pop style. You know what I mean? Well, no, people wanted Stevie Nicks. Yeah. And your mother didn't sing like Stevie Nicks.
Yeah. You know what I mean? What was she like? I mean, what attracted you to mom just beside her beauty?
We just got along together because, you know, I tell you, I still have the first two pieces of sheet music your mother gave me. The one is Always and Forever by Heatwave. You probably never heard of that. Yeah, but Just the Way You Are by
Forever. That song?
Yeah, that song. And then also, you know, Billy Joel, you know, Just the Way You Are. And the thing was that your mother could sing these, you know, and I was telling this, you know, to Wes, you know, a little while ago. I said, Donna could sing these things, but I could play it, and we used to rehearse it, but the band wasn't good enough to play it. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, like Always, you know, I mean, the, you know, Just the Way You Are is a pretty complicated tune, and those guys couldn't play it.
Yeah.
You know, but your mother could sing it and I could play it, but that's how we, like, you know, kind of hooked up with all that stuff.
Was she always that, as, you know, because if you met my mother recently, you know, she's a firecracker. She's like extremely outgoing. You know, loves being the center of attention, all that stuff. Was she always like that back in the day?
Oh, yeah. Meeting your mother was like uncorking your first bottle of champagne.
Well, hey, man, that's something to put on a tombstone right there. Holy shit. So how long after you'd been playing together did you guys start dating?
Oh, you're gonna get me in trouble here. I don't know. I guess about 2-3 months.
Why? That's not a bad.
Yeah, because time. we were rehearsing at your grandfather Jackson's house because they had an organ there
in the basement, like in the downstairs.
Yeah, yeah. Now I could tell you stories, but we're not gonna go into the whole sort of details here.
Hey, I'm just. What happened. I would just only, you know, because I lived at you know, my mother's parents' house, you know, for a long time. So I would always leave equipment in, you know, a lot of my equipment was stored in that room. I never got to play there outside of, you know, practicing my room and stuff. But so you were dating after two or three months. And then you guys never got married.
Right. We were supposed to, but it never pulled off.
Did you propose to her?
Yeah. We were supposed. We were actually planning the wedding with your, your grandmother and grandfather Jackson, but it just never went anywhere. So
what? So interracial couple, late '70s, early '80s. What was that experience like? I mean, was there? Did you talk about getting kicked out of the house around the time that you started dating mom? I mean. Your family, my grandmother, my grandfather, did they had some direct opposition to you dating a black woman?
I'm not going to comment on the family thing. Okay.
Why not?
Because it's too personal. But I will say this:
This is it, Dad. If you croak tomorrow, and I never know the story, you know, it's not really fair to me. Because, and here's okay. why, and here's okay. and here's why.
All right, here's
why I say that. I love your parents, my grandparents, and despite what had happened before I was there, it's a part of a time, you know. And I don't judge anyone. Like if the story is they were opposed to it and that there was racism at that time, that's part of that time. It's not necessarily a reflection of that person's morality. For me, I don't look at it that way because you know what. Because when I grew up, I experienced nothing but unconditional love for my grandparents, your parents.
Right.
So well, that's...
Well, the thing that I can say about this, I don't want to quote something because people are going to say to me that, like, I'm lying, and I'm not. But I will say this, that when me and your mother once started going out first in public and stuff as a couple, people used to spit at us.
Yeah.
You know? And my parents stopped talking to me. Didn't go over too well with her family. I'm not going to go into the details. But it was rough sledding. Then, you know, when she got pregnant with Dallas, you know, we had to move. We couldn't. And here's the thing, too.
Was that planned?
No. But the thing, though, is that we couldn't find an apartment.
Yeah.
People would not, because we were a mixed couple, like in New Brunswick and no place. And I'll tell you the funny story is that it was at Somerset Arms, I believe that's the name of the place, on Franklin Avenue in Somerset. This white guy, Earl, who was from the South, he had these three little kids running around his apartment, and me and your mother went there to get an apartment. And he said, oh yeah, sure, you can have an apartment, you know? So he let us in, you know? And that's when she was about 6 months pregnant. We searched for months. Yeah. We couldn't get an apartment because we were a mixed couple. And, you know, I mean, it was just rough times. And,
Dad, the reason why I bring this up is because right now we're in a moment in American history, you know, kind of living history, where people are talking about racism in America. Is America a racist country? Is it not a racist country? But so the reason why I think it's important to be honest about this stuff and tell people is that people, they think, you know, I grew up during the 80s when it was like the Cosby Show is on TV and Michael Jackson's the biggest star and Michael Jordan's the biggest star and pop culture pretended like racism didn't exist, right? They like whitewashed this idea, and but the reality of what was going on in people's lives, you know, is this. And it's important for you to tell that, because if you don't tell the story, people will say that, oh, everything was, what do you mean there was racism? Michael Jordan was making $100 million. You understand what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. No, I'll be honest with you. I mean, it was, you know, it was only directed because we were a mixed couple, but, you know, I mean, like I toured with, you know, all black groups through the South with the Coasters and, well, mostly with the Coasters with that. I mean, the other groups weren't, you know, black groups, but the thing that was that, like, you know, people used to come up to me and say, like, you know, how come a white guy like you is touring with all these black guys? And the Coasters are like, no, they're a rock and roll Hall of Fame group. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, you can't dismiss them, but we used to, I mean, we used to show up and we used to get fired. This is like 1980. We used to get fired because, you know, we'd be out in Butler, Pennsylvania playing some Holiday Inn, and they would say to us, well, no, we didn't know the Coasters were black people. Yeah. And they would fire us, you know. And the thing was, I had two kids in diapers and I had to make money, you know. So we would have like a 3-week gig and we get fired after about 3 days and they send us home, you know. So, I mean, it wasn't easy times, and the same thing too with, I mean, New Brunswick is okay, but, you know, I don't know.
Brunswick was pretty diverse and it was also, you know, a college town. So you had more kind of forward thinking, I would suppose. Yes, no, maybe.
Well, let's put it this way. I mean, I don't know if they still have it, but, you know, back in the day, the, you know, New Brunswick had the White Elks and the Black Elks.
Yeah.
So that I think that speaks for itself.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it does kind of, but it also speaks to, you know, how things evolve, right? So, you know, my experience growing up, you know, and like I said, I don't really remember shit before I was like 4 or 5 years old, but, you know, and one of my really my early memories is really you and mom splitting up. Like that's one of the first things I really remember. Like, and I don't have like a real granite hard idea of it. I just remember lots of arguing and yelling. I remember. And then you not being around as much for a while because when you guys first split up, we stayed at the house in New Brunswick or on Simplex Avenue, and then you kind of, you know, you were just probably figuring out how to make, you know, figure out life as a single person and getting your shit together so that you could like share custody and stuff.
Yeah, well, you know, eventually I got custody of you guys, but that's a different story. But
what was the main reason you and it didn't work out for you and mom, you think?
Your mother, well, you know what? I mean, you want me to go into this?
Yeah, man, come on. I mean, here's the thing, Dad.
Because your mother just said, like, you know, you pay for everything and I'm taking my money and spending it where I want. She didn't want to keep, you know, like, you know, putting money in together with everything. You know
she wanted to be a kept woman.
Well, she needed a sugar daddy, I suppose, you know?
Yeah. So, now, like I said, she's not here to speak for herself. And like I said, I originally wanted to get both of you on the show and tell your stories. And like I said, that's a massive regret of mine that, you know, which is why you shouldn't in life. You can't procrastinate. You just got to do shit. Even this, you know, between you and me, probably should have happened sooner.
Yeah, but if you had your mother on a show with me, you would have heard about two words out of me.
No. I would say I would have done separate shows. I would have done one show with her, one show with you.
Oh yeah. Okay.
And what I'm saying is that obviously, if you guys split up, and listen, as I've gotten, you know, older into my life, knowing my mother and knowing you, it's hard for me to even imagine you guys being together because your personalities are so different and your kind of your lifestyles are very different. And obviously that was something at one point you guys had a certain amount in common.
Oh, no. At one point, me and your mother were a team.
Yeah.
You know, we were like a super team, you know. But then, you know, I mean, things happened and stuff. And, you know, I mean, she just like, you know, wanted to do this and do that. And she didn't want to support the family. And it was a matter of, no, I mean, a lot of the family stuff is a matter of paying bills. You know what
yeah.
I mean?
Yeah.
And like, no, I mean, if like, no, if one per like, no, she said, well, you pay all the bills. And I would, well, I mean, it's just the way it happened.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's the way it is. But you know what? I always supported your mother and her music.
Yeah.
You know?
But eventually she, you know, so when I was kind of, you know, 6, 7, 8 years old, you know, she was still doing music, you know, a lot.
No, and she kept doing music for quite a while. She was doing like jazz singing and stuff. And I thought she was actually one of the best. Like, you know, this guy, Steve Nelson, who I think he's still alive, he's one of the greatest living vibes players if he's still kicking around. He said your mother was one of the best jazz singers alive, you know, in the tri-state area at that time. And she could really sing jazz stuff, you know, but then she abandoned that, you know. So, I mean, it was with her, it was a matter of changing. Eventually, she tried to do pop music and then she went to doing, you know, DJing. You know, so
well, it's my perspective on it is muddled because I was so young, you know, and I remember, you know, I was, you know, very idealistic about mom as a singer because she was, you know, she would like gas your head up for me. Like, she would like tell me, she's like, I'm gonna be a famous singer and I'm doing this, and you know, we'd be at, you know, and she'd take us to her rehearsals and she'd be, you know, and she was very much, you know, out there and kind of, you know, banging the drum for this stuff. And, you know, as that kind of, that time went on, you know, her kind of ability as, you know, just a mother and kind of home, you know, kind of taking care of the home degraded, you know, and that kind of coincided, I think, with her doing less music and then she started doing hair. You know, so like when we got to around 9, 10, 11 years old and music seemed to kind of go fade to the background in it. And for me, it created this sense of, I guess, cynicism about mom because I, like when she told me she was going to be a famous singer, I believed her, you know. And then when, you know, I was like, you know, and I think that's just, you know, because we're children, we want to believe our parents when they say things and we want to think that they have it all figured out. And then, but then when, like, you know, lights aren't on and there isn't enough food in the house and, you know, there was a lot of issues of just general responsibility things that made me harbor a lot of resentment towards mom because once you start getting old into 11, 12, things start to kind of come into clarity about, oh, listen, something's not right here.
Right.
You know, yeah. And you're like, well,
you know, I mean, with your mother too, there might have been mental health issues. You know, I mean,
of course,
I think that's, you know, something there. But, you know, I realized at one point that I better get custody or else you guys were going to be in super big trouble, which I did. I mean, and the thing about that, though, which I'm actually most proud of, one of the more proud things I am in my life, is that I got custody of you guys without a lawyer. In front of a female judge. And the thing though is that I prepared that case, you know, going like, well, when you know, when your mother shows up, you know, I mean, it's not going to be easy, but I'm going to have to prove my case. And I used to sit in my bedroom at, you know, Brunswick Arms and just do the case verbally for like 1 or 2 hours a day.
Yeah.
And I would just prepare the presentation and I got custody and that was that, you know. But I mean, some things happened after that, but after a while, everything, I tell you, the one person who, you know, was happy about that was Nana Jackson.
Yeah. Why? Oh, yeah.
She just like
our great grandmother, by the way, for people.
Yeah, yeah, Nana Jackson. She was born in 1900. I think she died in 1902. I think she lived to be 102. But the thing though is that, I mean, as soon as I got custody of you guys, she started bringing over like peanut butter and cheese and stuff, and just like, you know,
this is the government peanut butter that if you had like a Rambo knife, you couldn't cut into this peanut butter. It would. The government peanut butter was just too much, man.
But you could make some grilled cheese out of the motherfucker. You
know well, the mean? Cheese, well, the cheese is one thing. I was more talking about the peanut butter was rough because everyone likes peanut butter, but it just wasn't working. No, I mean, listen, this is so fascinating to me because, you know, especially with context of how rare it is, probably for a father to kind of be that demonstrative about wanting to take on the responsibility of two children. And you weren't, like I said, you weren't like some businessman out there, you know, making a ton of money. I mean, obviously you had a business, so I don't want to put in that, like you had a teaching business, self-employed.
Actually, you know what? I mean, the thing though is that with me, my piano business at that time was only, you know, maybe a quarter or half of what I did because I was working for Middlesex County. I was teaching sick kids at their homes.
Okay. So you were doing you were doing normal teaching, piano teaching, but you're also doing gigs on the weekends and nights. Right.
Yeah. I was doing that too. Yeah, I was working like 7 days a week.
Yeah.
But the thing though is that with you guys, hey, listen, I never planned to get custody of you. I only did it because I had to.
Yeah. Well, no, it was joint custody at first, you know, but we,
it was joint custody. And one of the reasons I did that because was your mother was threatening to move you to Florida.
Yeah. I think that was I would say it was an empty, I think that was an empty promise, but you know, the main thing about that court date, though, the big thing for us was we had to name who we wanted to live with.
Oh, really?
And we said that we wanted to live with you.
Oh, okay.
You know, because like I said, it was at about that time that it started to, like I said, because mom would, you know, still like she hit us. You never hit us. I think one time you got into a thing with Dallas, but that was like when you guys were older, you know.
Yeah, that's like, when he was 16. Yeah,
yeah.
Or 15, 16. Yeah. 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 I mean, that was a tough situation. But you know,
what I'm saying is there was a lot of instances, you know, where, you know, her, you know, the fact that she wasn't probably doing being as responsible as she needed to be, and that was apparent to us at that time. And I think a big part of that, us saying that and voicing that publicly, you know, probably hurt her relationship with us. Like, I think that was like made her probably angry at us for a while, you know. But it wasn't like we didn't see her at all. We would still go visit her, you know, like, cause she did hair down, you know, kind of downtown near Rutgers. Right. So we would go down there, and then I think what happened is when mom lost the house is kind of when she kind of disappeared for a while. It seemed like we didn't see her, you know, and I don't know what really happened during those years, you know. But, you know, listen, I kind of want to, you know, between me and you, I want to talk to all of her siblings and family and kind of just tell the story for mom that she couldn't tell herself, you know, and kind of fill in the blanks as much as possible, you know, for better or for worse, you know, because, you know, the story, my story with mom was all that childhood stuff. I resented her for a long time, you know.
Yeah.
You know, and then because I ended up living in my grandparents' house and she lived there and she had kind of given up on being adults. And kind of, you know, she was basically a 50 something year old kid at home, basically with her parents.
Yeah.
And it made me lose respect for her. And through those intervening years, I came to forgive mom for, you know, her, you know, things I felt like weren't right when we were younger. But I also do think she did try harder as she got older. And I think she did try to reconcile. I think it became clearer to her, even though she was could be very abrasive in general. But anyway, and I'm just saying that because I don't want to, you know, if we go down a lot of these pathways, it could just look like we're shitting our mom.
I don't hold any animosity towards anybody, you know. And the only thing, you know what? Hey, listen, man, I ain't getting no younger, but you know what? All I do is like I teach, and you know, it's like, you know, you, like Dr. King said, you're looking over the mountaintop. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well,
might not get to the promised land, but I'm teaching those kids, you know, to play music, you know? Yeah. And that'll last them a lifetime longer than I'll be around.
Yeah. Well, so I kind of want to talk about kind of the period from when Weeds went to live with you. I think I was in third grade, Dallas was in fourth grade. And that's when we started going to Redshaw. When we lived on Livingston Avenue.
Right. And the thing was that, like, because see, like, I was working at night, and then you would have to walk up to 27 to go to your mother's shop, and then your mother would watch you. Then I'd pick you up.
Well, the shop on 27 was later. She worked at Eclipse. Down on Easton, right by Easton Avenue, which was closer. 27 was a little later, pretty much up until I want to say right before high school. But so it wasn't like we never saw her. But you know, this period, I imagine, was a lot of kind of figuring it out as you went along.
Well, you know me, I was having a nervous breakdown every 3 weeks.
Yeah, well, so this time period, we have alcoholism runs in our family,
right?
You know, and I'm saying this with the perspective of being older and having more kind of empathy for your position and trying to understand how much pressure and how difficult it must have been to, you know, basically be on your own. You know, you weren't getting any support from mom, as far as I know, to help raise and pay for kids. You know, we were in a one-bedroom apartment, and me and my brother slept in the living room, you know, on these, like, we didn't even have our own room, like, you know. And, you know, but I never thought anything of it, you know what I'm saying? Like, I felt like me and Dallas had each other, always. You know what I'm saying? And we were, you know, artistically inclined from a really young age, you know, so we were always like drawing and, you know, doing, and kind of, you know, it's so funny. There's this documentary about Action Park. Remember that place in Vernon? Like, they talk about how it was like, you know, just a nightmare, like the amount of people that were injured and people were killed there. And it was just, but they were speaking about how in the 80s, and probably when you were a kid too, it's like you would just get on your bike and just leave the house and you'd come back when it was night and no one really cared, you know? Yeah. And so when we were kids, we would do that, you know, we got all kinds of dumb kid, but it was kid trouble. It wasn't like we were out doing heroin in the woods. We would, like, you know, egg a house or like,
yeah, but eventually though, once you became about 13 or 14, you became afraid of going outside because the neighborhood was that bad.
I think it's when you're really young, people don't really mess with you, but when you get to that certain age, like, right, people kind of want to challenge you. And so, yeah, well, we were,
the other thing too in that neighborhood, like living on Brunswick Arms, when you were about 7 or 8 years old, you know, I mean, we would, like, I'd be taking you to school on Monday morning and there'd be hypodermic needles on the ground, you know? Yeah. So the neighborhood wasn't, you know, that good of a neighborhood. And, you know, the drug dealers were down on Joyce Kilmer Avenue. So that place was not, ideal America. You know, let's put it that way. You know what I mean?
Well, so, it's not when you kind of have to. I always knew, like, all right, you can walk here, and it's pretty cool. You walk here, but I remember, like, I had a bully. I don't know if you remember this dude named Hassan Fuqua, who, like, without, like, you know, like in the hood, what they would do is, like, yo, man, like, they wouldn't just directly rob you. They would try and punk you out to take your thing. So there's one kid, he'd be like, yo, man, yo, that's my cousin's bike. And I'm like, no, it's not. And you just try and, like, you know, avoid the conflict. But eventually this guy, we were playing basketball not that far away, and I didn't like him because he was always trying to, I was trying to mess with me, steal my bike. He goes, what's up? And I said, this is a total Kevin Coyle move, by the way. I say, the sky. And he punches me right in the face. It's like the only, like I said, my fight career isn't really a history of fights. It's a picture of me getting hit and it, like, it gets broken up.
My fight career is the same. I got these scars on my face just getting hit. You know what I mean? So I mean, it's nothing more than that. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I mean, that whole, like, you know, New Brunswick thing, I mean, it was a rough neighborhood, but, you know, I mean, you had good teachers there and stuff, you know.
Well, no, there was so much there. Because that was, you know, living at that Brunswick Arms, it was a very much it takes a village vibe. Yeah. We had the neighbors, you know, Mark's parents.
Dawn and Skippy.
You know, where we could stay with them. And this was like when video games were coming out. So we'd be, you know, we'd play Nintendo all day and stuff. And then we had the superintendent, Mike, who, you know, really took us under his wing and would take us out for breakfast and lunch. And he would take us to the woods.
All those guys there, like, you know, it's like, it's very interesting because that place, I mean, they love you guys like, we used to leave our apartments open, you know, and then you and Mark used to run back between the two apartments, you know, like, you know, the thing with that was beautiful about that though, was that, you know, when I was off, you know, you guys, all three of you came over. Then when, you know, I had to work, then you went to Dawn's place. But no, the apartments were always open and stuff. And it was just, you know, I mean, yeah, you're right. It was like a community thing where it was like, you know, and also you got to remember Bob and Sarah.
Yeah, Bob. So Bob and Sarah were graduate students for Rutgers, her sociology. So they were like this, you know, typical kind of university, you know, I guess, I don't, you know, I, you know, like what I would consider like the college people that listen to like REM, like what you think of at that time. And they were just the nicest people in the world. And there was this period where we went to, what are you going to say? Sorry.
No. I mean, to me, it was funny because, like, again, you know, I had weird work hours because I was a piano teacher, but I would always, like, you know, every Friday they would take you to the bar to play pool.
Yeah.
You know, and then at 6 or 7 o'clock, you know, I would go and pick you up and I'd be sitting in the back, you know, going like, they're playing pool with all these college graduate students. And it was the funniest thing in the world because you were hanging out. I mean, because you and Dallas were pretty mature for your age, you know?
Yeah, but it seemed like all the people we hung out with were older. So around that time,
I mean, I'm like Attila.
Yeah, so we had a buddy, Attila, who was Hungarian, and he was like, he was probably like 7 or 8 years older than we were, but, you know, because I think when we were like 12, you know, maybe even a little more, because we were like 12 or 13, and he was probably 18, 19, 20, and we met him at the comic book store, and he, like, basically him and his girlfriend, Helen, same thing. They just kind of took us under their wing and they'd take us to comic book shops and show us anime. And like, it really was very wholesome. It was like every enclave just kind of took us under their wing and they didn't treat us like kids. They kind of just like brought us into their world. But like, it wasn't like we were at the bar doing shots. They would get us.
But the thing is, But you hung out with Attila for years because I remember when they moved to um, North Brunswick. I used to take you out to their house in North
Brunswick. We helped them move.
Right, yeah. I remember that. And the other thing, too, is remember Matthew, my piano student who worked at the comic book store?
Yeah.
You met him? Yeah, yeah. And I took you to his parents' home. That was funny as hell. I mean, you just met him. It's talk about a small world. It's like you just met him by accident. He's my piano student. And then, like, his parents wanted to meet you, and I took you over to the parents' house in East Brunswick. So all this stuff, I mean, yeah, I mean, it's kind of, you've led an interesting life.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is it was just, I think from a certain person's perspective, you could say, hey, well, you know, these kids, they came up and they didn't have a lot of money and they didn't, you know, maybe the neighborhood is a little dangerous, but we really had a lot of communal support. We had, we would go to Grant, you know, your parents' house
right,
almost yeah. every weekend, or we go to my mother's parents' house. So there was a, you know, it's when I was talking to Aunt Karen, you know, and she was saying how she described our childhood as like challenging. She was like, you guys had it rough. That's how she kind of put it. But I never viewed it. And I, from her perspective, I could see what she means in terms of, you know, maybe lack of consistency in terms of the unit or moving around or maybe dealing with certain things. But I never viewed it that way because I always felt like we always did have a lot of support from friends and family and I never viewed it that way, and I felt it was very enriching to get different input, you know what I'm saying, from like all these, like I said, we were, you're hanging out with sociology majors in college, you're being exposed to things, you know, we would get taken to museums, we would get taken to ballet, we would get yeah, Jeff and his girlfriend who helped us with guitar, like he would show us a lot of guitar stuff, and then Chris Chris and Janice
right, yeah, and I used to take you down to South Jersey and you would hang out there for the whole weekend.
Yeah, so for some reason, like I said, I don't know if this is normal, but we just had so much support and everyone was amazing to us. And so I always felt really lucky in that regard, and having all this exposure to kind of like extended family and people help. Like I said, it very much is takes a village. And I felt that was very relevant and very kind of, you know, it seeps into kind of who you are, you know, and I think into whatever unique perspective I have, you know, is that broader education outside of just books in school. But anyway, like I said, this whole section, I don't know if anyone's going to give a shit about this except you and I,
well, for me, you know, I mean, as far as being a parent, you know, I was an improviser. I just flew by the seat of my pants. Yeah. I basically, like, no, I just said, well, let's see, well, we'll keep these two boys alive. We'll see what goes on from there.
Well, so by the time we got to high school, though, actually, one thing I want to talk about before that, by the time we did get to high school, was like when grunge and like alternative music was kind of getting really big. And right. You started, so even before that, like you were into like Public Enemy, and you would, you know, you'd buy the records, and then you got into, you know, you were at a certain point, we were all listening to the same music. So we were listening to Nirvana and Pearl Jam and Nine Inch Nails and Rage Against the Machine. And I always thought that was really cool that you were someone who was not like stuck in a certain era. Like you were willing to kind of evolve with the times, you know, like what was it about that era of music that you felt connected to?
I don't know. I mean, it was just like, no, once I discovered, like, Public Enemy, I knew from the Village Voice, you know? And, like, I used to read the articles on Public Enemy, and then I started buying her, you know, the cassettes back then. They were cassettes. But I'm like, this stuff is great. You know, I mean, it was the closest thing to, you know, like, you know, the jazz, like, the electric jazz that I grew up with, and I really liked that stuff. And the same thing with, like, Pearl Jam. Nirvana was good, but, I mean, like,
You like the last record. In Utero is the one you really liked.
Yeah, that one I like. Yeah, I think that's their best record. It's also the roughest record and roughest to a certain extent to listen to, but it's still, I still think it's their greatest record. But no, I mean, that time period, Nine Inch Nails, all that stuff. I mean, you know, I mean, certain people turn me on to that stuff, but no, I always keep up with stuff and I keep up with stuff now. It's like, hey, listen, you know, the kids got me onto Billie Eilish. No, I'm listening to, like, you know, I mean, you can't, Harry Styles, like, I'll listen to Harry Styles music, you know. It's like, no, I mean, to this day, it's like, I'm still doing it. I mean, what the hell is that damn song? The little kids like this song. I don't have the list here, but it's like the Monster Dance or like, no, the Dance Monster or something, and little kids like it. But the thing was that, like, no, I've always kept up with, you know, the music styles, and that's mostly because, like, no, I'm a piano teacher, and you have to, no, you have to keep up with the new stuff. I mean, you just can't lay off on, like.
So around that time is right around me and Dallas started kind of started playing guitar, wanting to get into guitar. Like, what's your memory? Because my memory is like, I somehow had this beat up acoustic and I was plucking away on it. And somehow you saw me doing that. And then Robin, your girlfriend at the time, who's still a amazing family friend, She lent you her Ibanez, Les Paul, and then you gave that to me when I think was going from seventh grade to eighth grade or eighth grade into ninth grade, I think. And then but what do you remember about me wanting to play guitar?
Well, it's actually more about Dallas wanting to play guitar.
I was first.
No, I don't think so.
I was.
Well, you know what? Here's what I remember, according to me. Dallas was playing first trumpet in the band. When he went into seventh grade, they made him join marching band, and they made him march in 100-degree heat, and he quit the next day. And he said, "Dad, I want to play guitar." So I got him guitar lessons with Mike DiFilippo.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure what he was playing on, but the thing, though, is that, you know, I mean, let's see. What, I started going out with Robin in 1992, I believe. So I think that was the year. So, I mean, you guys were like, yeah, about that time period. I think Robin just lent
me. Well, I was 12. He was 13.
Yeah. So I think she just, like, you know, and the thing was that Dallas was studying with Mike DiFilippo, and he was showing you the licks that Mike DiFilippo taught him. And Mike DiFilippo, by the way, for all you folks out there, North Brunswick School of Music, Mike DiFilippo, bad motherfucker. He's still teaching. So the thing, though, is that he started teaching Dallas, and then Dallas started teaching you the stuff. And then eventually, you know, you both got guitars and used to sit in the, you know, in the apartment just practicing. You know what? I was doing weddings. I would leave at 12 o'clock in the afternoon, come back at 8 o'clock at night, and you guys be playing all day long.
Yeah.
You know, so that's how you got good. You know, I mean, you weren't sitting around your asses going, like, you know, let's, you know, become good guitar players. You were working at it. You know what I mean?
Well, it was, you know, I think the way I was about things, and to a certain degree I still am, is like when I get into something, I get into it 100%, right? So it's like when I'm drawing comic books, I'm drawing comics all day. I'm collecting comic books all day. It's all I'm thinking about. And then with guitar, it just, you know, it came more natural. So, you know, because I mentioned this on the show, but, you know, that, you know, I was accepted to Joe Kubert Comic Book Art School.
Right.
And then, but ultimately we ended up deciding to go to college, you know, to William Patterson and as an art major, you know, and I had to, like, present my portfolio and everything. And, you know, but music, guitar just came easier. It seemed to come more naturally. And yeah, and it becomes an obsession. Like I said, I didn't realize we were good at all until we left the house and started playing with Corey and Byron, you know. Well, and even then, it's not that I felt we were good, but they were like, oh, you guys are pretty good. But we were, like I said, we probably only been playing for maybe 2 or 3 years.
Yeah, yeah. But the thing is that, like, though, I mean, your fans might not know this, but I used to drive you out to the house in the on Somerset Street. Like,
yeah.
Right. Every like, you know, Saturday or Sunday afternoon. But do you want me to describe your first gig, your live gig?
Oh, I would love it. It was great. I could tell you, I always tell people what you said.
Yeah, yeah. No. I mean, I'm talking about the Plum Street gig, not the Core Tavern.
Well, the Core Tavern is the first gig, though. But
Well, actually, the Plum Street is the funniest one.
Okay.
Because the thing was that the Plum Street, you know, they had the bar there, right? So you had that kind of like, you know, rectangle bar, and you guys were way in the front, you know. So I just sat in the back because you're playing really loud. And there are all these regulars in the back, and I got my beer, and I'm going like, yeah, 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 I'm watching the band. And once you stop playing, all these people say, this band sucks. I said, who are these guys? I'm going like, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah.
I'm like, I don't know who these guys are.
Hey, but drink more, they'll sound better.
Yeah, but at the Core Tavern, yeah, you guys were out of tune. I'm like, man, you guys got to keep in.
That's what he said. That's what we got off our first gig. I'm 16 years old. I'm a sophomore in high school. Get off the stage, and my dad goes, "Is literally what he says." He goes, "You were out of tune."
No, really. I mean, like, it's funny. No, but
But you know what's funny that I think about is that, you know, we never had yes men. Right, there was no one around us when it came to music that ever told us we were good when we weren't. You know, because I can imagine if you have like a real, if you have a, like a parent or like friends or family that are too encouraging, they're like, "Oh, that was great," when you actually weren't. Then it doesn't make you want to get better. You know, so we always were aware of our limitations, and so we constantly pushed us to like, gotta get better, gotta get better, gotta get tighter, gotta, you know what I'm saying? Like it was, and that was something, it never was like, oh, that's abusive or anything like that. It's like, I think that is helpful. Like you want someone to be, like if you're not doing something right, you need someone to tell you it's not right. Dude.
Well, you know, I mean, you always heard me practicing because
you practice all day.
Yeah, I still practice. I still practice an hour to every day. You know, like now with this COVID thing, I mean, the world is like, you know, kind of like all sort of upside down. But I tell you, you know, God forbid, you know, when you guys were on, you know, you guys sounded like, you know, I mean, when I saw you play these places, and when you were on, you sounded like the Miles Davis band from the 70s. You know, you were kicking. I mean, like when Beaker and Corey, when that, you know, rhythm section was on and you and Dallas were swinging, man. That was a swinging band, you know, and I used to sit in the back and say, these motherfuckers sound black. No, really. It's like, no, I mean, it's really funny, you know, and you know, it just kind of cracked me up. I'm like, these guys are good, you know, and then again, you know, I mean, the trouble with music is being consistent,
yeah.
You know, and that's what, you know, you got to really work at that. It's not an easy thing to do, but you guys were good, man. It's like, I like your stuff now, but your God forbid stuff, that was kind of like really, at the time, that was really good.
Well, let me, like, what was your whole perspective on, you're a musician, but you're not, you know, it wasn't like you were earning your living as a recording and performing musician for the most part. By the time we got to, you know, high school age, I mean, did it bother you at all that like, oh man, these guys are going down this like kind of dead end path, you know, and maybe they should do something a little more dependable? Did that ever kind of cross you? Because I don't ever remember, I don't think you ever dissuaded us or didn't encourage us, but you definitely wanted us to go to college, which is why me and Dallas each, I think, made it a semester.
Yeah, yeah, that's about it.
Or no, Dallas did a summer program, and yeah. I don't think he actually made, where did he go? Not Seton Hall, he went somewhere, I'm forgetting where he went.
Was it Montclair?
Montclair, I guess, yeah. But he went, yeah. So he went basically for a summer session, and I did one semester at William Patterson. And I think because, you know, neither he or I had much of a plan out, you know, what we wanted to do with our lives, but we knew we just loved the band. That's all we really knew. And because we loved the band so much, we just didn't really give a shit about school.
Right. Yeah. No, I know. Yeah. You know, I mean, I was going like, oh man.
By the way, guys, he's smacking his face. He's face palming.
Just what we need. Two more musicians in the goddamn family. Yeah. No, really. And that's what I thought. I'm like, oh man. It's like, I thought like, no, one musician is bad enough. And now we got these guys coming up. Yeah. No, I mean, after a while, I'm going like, ah, screw it. I mean, I wasn't going to, you know, it's funny. Dallas's counselor from Montclair called me up and said, you know, Dallas is dropping out. And I'm going, you know, I don't know. I said, I mean, it's up to him. He goes, no. He says, you got to talk to him. You got to keep him in. And then I talked to Dallas, and Dallas said, I can't stand school.
Yeah.
I've had enough school.
Well,
and that was it.
You know? Well, I mean, did you pay for his classes too? Or he got a scholarship or something?
I think he got a scholarship. Your school I paid for.
I know.
But Dallas, though, I think he got a partial scholarship for that, but I don't remember. It's so long ago.
Well, the funny thing is, in a way, when I told you I didn't want to go back to school, you actually seemed relieved because you didn't have to pay for it anymore. You're like, oh, you're not going? Hey.
No. That wasn't it. I paid for it. And, you know, I mean, I was.
But like, I didn't do well. I like failed like one or two of the classes. I didn't, you know.
One or two. It was like five or six.
I only took like five classes. The fuck out of here.
Yeah. So it was five.
Okay? I didn't fail all my classes. All right.
Well, you got one D and four Fs. Okay. I don't have
the proof in front of me, but.
Yeah. You know what? Hey, listen, I got all my college transcripts right here. So you can look at my college transcripts any day you want. But the thing I was at, like, they mailed home the grades. I'm going like, you gotta be fucking kidding me, you know? So that was that.
Yeah. Well, I think ultimately it was just, I didn't want to be there.
No. I told you when you went to school, I said, if you get one F, that's it. I'm not paying for school.
Yeah.
And you got, you know, at least three or four.
Yeah. So, well, let me say this. I did feel bad, and I, you know, I hope that counts for something.
Hey, you didn't pay the money. I'm talking about feeling bad, you know. So,
Dad, who just got a new computer and new TV? Okay, I'm paying you back slowly but surely. All right, calm down. All right.
Well, I appreciate that.
All right.
But back in the day.
I know
it kind of hit hard.
I understand, but me not going back. At least you didn't require any expense. But anyway,
yeah. But the thing that was out, you guys though. I mean, you signed your first record deal, which impressed me. You know, with what was that company?
Century Media.
Was it Century Media?
Yeah, but that was within a year of us leaving school. Me and Dallas both, we got a record deal. Yeah. I was 19, Dallas was 20. So, and then, you know, and then we started touring quite a bit, and then, you know, and kind of getting out there, and we still, you know, the early days, we didn't make any money, even though we were like out on the road all the time. And that kind of, you know, at that time we kind of, it had run its course, you know, cause that, you know, I still remember 9/11, you know, it's like me and Dallas shared, you know, we had at this point we had upgraded to a two-bedroom apartment. So me and Dallas were 20, you know, 21-year-old men sharing a room. Like that was the upgrade, was to get to share a room. So but I remember like living in that apartment in East Brunswick and just like waking up, and we had just got off another tour. And like seeing, I remember like turning on that TV and it was like, you know, when the 9/11 happened, that was like, and we didn't live with you like not too much longer after that. And then ended up.
But the thing that would happen with that, it's kind of funny. That's stuck in my mind too, because I had this adult student named Dawn, and I called her up like 9 o'clock in the morning or 9:30. And I said, Dawn, are we on for the lesson today? And she said, did you see the TV? And I said, no. She goes, this plane just hit into the World Trade Center. And that's when I woke you up. I said, Doc in Dallas, I said, get up. And because I turned, because we had no cable back then, and we turned the cable on, it was, and that was a big thing. The other thing, too, I remember living with you guys was the 2000 election with George W. Bush.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have great memories. I just remember, you know, everything being up in the air about the results. And then that kind of politically activated me because, you know, then the Michael Moore documentary came out about, because you had, you know, all within a short time, you had the Florida situation with the votes. And then you had 9/11 all within, you know, a year and a half of each other. And all of a sudden, I remember, like, I think you gave me a Al Franken book.
Okay.
You know, that I read. And, you know, and that was kind of, you know, my entry point, that and kind of the Michael Moore documentary into, like, progressive politics, you know, partisan progressive politics. Like, I've gotten, you know, as I've gotten older, I've become more, you know, interested and educated about the complete political spectrum and not, you know, like I said, you're me, when you and me argue about politics, it's like me, I'm trying to give you more of a cultivated kind of wide perspective, and you're definitely, you know, coming more from a left perspective. But
I'm way more radical than you. You know, Dallas asked me after your mother passed away, he said to me, was mom a radical? I said, you're goddamn right she was. You know, so, your mother was very radical, especially back in the day. I mean, we both were, you know. And I think, you know, I mean, well, I don't know. I mean, it's you know, I mean, Jesus Christ. I mean, a lot of this stuff is going to affect everything. And, you know, me being a teacher and stuff, you know, I don't see the kids going back to school, you know. I mean, it's going to be a tough situation. I mean, we're living in really in different times now as far as COVID does, because like you, I mean, for yourself, you're not touring, you know, I'm not teaching at home. And, you know, I'm not a big, you know, go out and play, you know, in public sort of guy, but, it's, you know, it's just kind of different times now.
Yeah. Well, you know, I just what I was kind of alluding to before we kind of went a little more towards what's going on now. You know, we had this kind of period where, so we eventually left the house. You know, this is during kind of, God forbid, first year touring, and I think just we were just at that age where we kind of needed to kind of get out on our own. Yeah. And you know, we went to live at our grandparents' house. And pretty much, you know, from that point, from 2002, I lived at grandma's house till 2011. So I was there, you know, that whole time. And in many ways, it's fun. I think we had fraught periods within our relationship. But the thing I noticed was, as we got more kind of independence, it, like, you just in general, you were a very high strung person and who kind of held a lot of stress, you relaxed in your life. You seem to be when that, not, you know, kind of once the kids were out, because you still had that parental thing of like, hey Doc, here's $50, you know, so you have gas money. You know, you'd always do. You still would have that wanting to take care of us kind of thing, but just at a distance. Right. And you know, I think it gave you some kind of solace of like, you know what, I did my duty as a parent. They're adults. Some they're doing something of some value in the world, and we appear to not be complete idiots or failures to a certain degree.
But no, it's kind of like launching a ship. You know, you take that bottle and go, whoosh,
yeah,
launched. You know, so that was it. You know, yeah, I don't know. I mean, a lot of times you just got to cut the ties and stuff and see what the hell happens. I mean, it's you know, I don't know.
I mean, what did you think about us kind of developing, you know, a real kind of music career and kind of being international and, you know, putting out multiple records and, you know, eventually, you know, you see something like Ozfest, we're out there, we're playing in front of, you know, fucking.
Oh, that was great. I love that. I love that, you know.
I mean, go ahead.
Do you want me to tell them the story about Ozfest?
Sure.
You gave me the ticket for Ozfest, and this goes back years ago when you actually had a real camera. This, I forget what year it was, but
2004.
So they allowed me into Ozfest with this camera, and then I got to backstage, and then they said to me, "You can't go on there, you know, with the camera because it's against the rules." And I said, "Well, you know, Doc and Dallas are my sons," and they said, "Oh, okay, go ahead on stage." So the thing was that I'm like, you're on stage doing the whole show, and I'm on there taking pictures, you know? And after you got done, like, no, the security guards came up to me and said, "You can't be up here. Get out of here," you know? And they chased me off, but I got a whole roll of film, and I gave that to your grandmothers for their Christmas present that year, you know? So they kind of like that. And I got a kick, too, because I'm sitting up there taking pictures and I'm running on stage and there's like 2,000 people out in front of it. It was kind of cool, you know? So,
I mean, did you ever think we would get to that point where we're on tour with like Ozzy Osbourne? I remember listening to so one of the big like life-changing things, and I have to thank you for this, is like for Christmas and our birthdays, you started giving us CDs and stuff. And it was like, and I remember the one Christmas you gave us Ride the Lightning by Metallica and Injustice for All. And it was like,
right. Yeah.
Was like, holy shit. Right. And then I don't know if it was the year before or after you, maybe the year before you gave us Metallica Live Shit, Binge and Purge, the live box set. And right. It was like the whole world changed. But I remember there was this thing where I was watching Metallica on MTV or something. And you and the superintendent, Mike, were kind of like almost slightly making fun of me for listening to Metallica. Like you were almost treating Metallica like it was like a fad or something. Or like, it's what are you doing over there, kid, listening to this music? And then, you know, and then they're ultimately like the biggest band in the world. And then eventually, fast forward fucking 20, 15 years, I'm on tour with Metallica. Now I play in a band with the guys in Metallica. I mean, is that, do you think about that?
Well, tell them the story about you going out with Metallica and tell them that your father never liked Metallica.
Did I say that? I don't remember that.
You remember that story?
No.
Yeah, you said Metallica took you out to dinner, right?
Yeah. I'm sure I mentioned it, but there's a lot of drinking going on.
Yeah. But the thing, though, is that you said to me, you know, Daddy says, like, no, Metallica took me out to dinner. And you know, I told him, I said, you know, my father never liked you guys. And then I guess it was Helfrich said to you, if that's the guy's name.
Hetfield,
yeah. He said to you, what type of music does your father listen to? And you said jazz. And then he said, well, we listen to jazz too.
I don't remember any of this, but I'll take your word for it.
Yeah. Hey, you told me that story. So I thought that was funny.
We know the bass player, Rob, he did a documentary on Jaco Pastorius.
Yeah, I mean, Jaco was a big guy when I was, in my 20s. I mean, he's like a big influence on a lot of people. But, you know,
the documentary's on Hulu if you want to watch it, the one that Robert got made. You should check it out.
Yeah, no, I mean, Jocko's big, but no, he played with Weather Report with Joe Zawinul and Wayne Shorter. And like I said, Zawinul is like, you know, one of the piano players when I was 13 years old, you know, that I still, to this day, I still try to play like Zawinul. I mean, do you have any seminal guitar players that you definitely follow?
I mean, you know, it's so interesting, and I think about this all the time, because the soundtrack to our childhood was Duke Ellington and Miles Davis and Louis Armstrong and, you know, all these, this just jazz music and avant-garde music, right? But I don't really look at it directly. Like probably out of all that stuff, the stuff I identify the most with is Miles Davis music, because there's something about it that feels dark in a way, like that's more to my sensibilities. Like, as someone who likes heavy metal and darker music, there's an edge to it that I kind of like, I identify with. But as a guitar player, I never really studied it, right? So, you know, it's interesting though, because I think, like, you know, playing with Rob Trujillo, with you know, his band Mass Mental and the Wedding Band, there's a lot of funk stuff, right? But I never grew up playing funk. But I think a lot of the stuff, just growing up in our household, like, I feel like I absorbed it kind of subconsciously.
Yeah.
Where I kind of just feel the vibes of it, even if I don't know it, even if I didn't study it kind of explicitly. You know, I wonder, you know, I feel like there is an L, and even the same thing, you listen to God Forbid, there's these weird off-color kind of experimental places that the band would go that I think if we didn't grow up with all that eclectic music, that wouldn't be there, even if we never studied it, you know?
No. I remember when you were like 7 or 8, do you remember that WKCR, like that guy Phil Schaap used to do those shows, and you would say, "Dad, why are you listening to this guy?" You know? And remember, it was like all the like the birthday celebrations they used to do.
Yeah, I knew every year who birthday it was by what was on the radio. Yeah. No, but my favorite thing about is the jazz DJ. It's like, so right now you just heard one of the rare recordings from Duke Ellington, and then they list everyone who's on it that featured John Balsamic on the upright bass, and who, and then I'll give you little details who actually he had been playing with Duke for about 12 years, you know. So I love that the jazz DJ speaking patterns, and it's not only a DJ, he's a historian. He's letting you know who's on the track,
right? But the
where it was recorded.
But this one year they put on this recording, and you were about 8 or 9 years old or so, and you know, Phil Schaap said, "Oh yeah, this is Duke Ellington and Louis Armstrong." And you turned around to me and said, "Do you mean to tell me that Duke Ellington played with Louis Armstrong?" But the thing was that you were aware. You know what I mean? Like, you knew shit when you were like, 9 or 10 years old. And that's, you know, that's basically the only credit you can give me. It's like I kept you aware of stuff. And I think it was I didn't start listening to Miles Davis again until he died in 1991. So you guys were like, you know, 12 or 13 years old when I started re-listening to Miles, because I did a whole reassessment of Miles. And Miles, I mean, he's like the Picasso of jazz. I mean, the guy just, you know, he had a tremendous influence. And, like I said, you know, I keep up on all this stuff now with what the kids want to play.
Yeah, but listen, I think you kind of exposing us to irreverent art goes beyond just music. I mean, I saw Reservoir Dogs for the first time with you. I saw, you know, Amadeus with you. You know, the Glenn Gould film, the Marx Brothers. Like I said, it goes beyond, you know, the Thin Man, and, you know, things like that. And just having contextual basis of like really like understanding what was going on in the past, and because I think a part of the reason why so much, you know, I think bad, you know, not that, you know, I'm in a position to call anything bad art, but I think art that is lesser than doesn't understand historical context. You know, and so when I think about music and film and the things that I love, I do feel like I have a pretty decent backdrop of where everything kind of comes from, at least, you know, within the 20th century.
You know, I think, you know, it's interesting that, like, you know, as you as kids and me, you know, I mean, you used to go to Blockbuster and stuff and say, "Well, let's rent this movie, let's rent that movie." And then once I got Reservoir Dogs, we watched that. That kind of changed everything.
Yeah.
You know, that really kind of changed everything as far as a.
Did you go with us to the movies with me, Dallas, and John to go see Pulp Fiction?
Did you
Do you remember John was laughing so hard during when he shoots him in the face? And our buddy John, we call JL, he would draw comic books with Dallas and I, and he was how we met Corey and Byron, because his cousin was the house that we went to. So he was like the link between the comic book art world and the heavy metal world. But he had one of the best and most contagious laughs of any human being time. And during the scene in Pulp Fiction where Marvin gets shot in the face, he literally laughed for like 7 minutes straight, but you couldn't help but laugh along with him, you know, but it was fucking great.
Yeah, no, I mean, no, it's funny. And the other thing too, one of the funny things, you had two friends named Byron, and it was Black Byron and White Byron.
Yeah. Oh, so this is great. So White Byron pretty much looks like a future senator. You know, this like clean cut.
But he was working for the mafia eventually.
Was he? I have no idea. So White Byron, the funny thing, so he looked like the most clean cut, just like I said, looked like a future senator. And Black Byron, a singer from God Forbid, obviously, he was, you know, black dude, dreads, you know, looks like a militant, you know, predator dude, not a predator, like the predator, and from the movies. And I remember we were going to take a trip to Ohio because Black Byron was at recording school and we were going to record a demo. And so Black grandfather let us use his RV to take all the equipment, go to Ohio, record this demo. And the only thing that made him feel safe was that he knew White Byron was coming along and that he was going to drive. And I really think the reason why he wanted him to drive was he's like, if this clean cut white boy is driving, they won't get pulled over. And Byron took it so seriously, this responsibility of driving the RV. And it was hilarious because you had Black Byron, who was fine and nice, but everyone trusted White Byron, but he was really the crazy one. White Byron was crazy. This dude, I remember one of the last times I hung out with him, we went out drinking. This dude was doing push-ups while drinking beer that was on the concrete. And I was like, I can't hang out with White Byron anymore. He's too crazy. But, you know, I don't know. Listen, I don't know what anyone gets out of that story. It was just funny times.
But the thing I was asking, because when we were living in like New Brunswick or like East Brunswick, you go like it's like Byron did this. I said I would say White Byron or Black Byron. And you said Black Byron. White Byron. You know, it's like it was really funny. It's like you didn't know who you were talking about. You know, so it was pretty funny.
Well, listen, Dad, we've covered a lot. I can say in the kind of intervening years, you and I have had a great relationship. I think personality wise, I think you and I are very similar kind of in our rhythms. I think I pick up a lot of that from you. You know, we're both very independent people. We like our time to ourselves.
That's fine. That's fine. It's like, don't praise me too much. You know?
I'm not praising or not praising. I'm just saying, I feel like, through the ups and downs, we've maintained a good relationship that's collegial and consistent. Collegial and consistent coils.
My grandmother Coyle, who was a she-he, she never said coil. She said curls.
Curls?
The curls, yeah. Like, no, it's like some people in Ireland can't pronounce the oi sound.
Yeah.
So they say curls.
Curls. It probably sounds better with an Irish accent. Hey, the curls.
Curls, yeah, yeah.
Curls, do better.
But the thing, though, is that I'll tell you a funny story. Do you remember when I did those studio sessions for you for God Forbid?
Yes, which needs to be noted that Dad played on a couple God Forbid records, which is why he is known as Dad Forbid.
So this is true. But this is the unknown story that I had this student named Buddy Fingerhut, and this guy, he died about 10 years ago. He died. He was about 80 years old when he died. And I used to tell him, I said, Buddy, it's like, no, I'm doing this session for my sons on their recording. And he said, what are they paying you? I said, I'm doing it for free. He said, make them pay you.
We should have paid. Now I feel like I got to send you $100 for your time.
More than that.
Wait, you in out an hour. What are you talking about? How much you make an hour teaching?
You don't want to know.
Well, I'm just saying, I ain't make no money off those albums. No, we're, you know, every album we pretty much put the money into the budget, you know, but you still should have been paid, so.
Yeah, well, no, it's funny, but Buddy used to say, and Buddy at the time was in his 70s, and he'd say, Kevin, make sure you make your sons pay you the money, man. I said, yeah, sure. It's like, but I never did though. But yeah, but I always enjoyed that stuff. You know, I mean, that was a kid. That was probably like the biggest kick for me, just, you know, being able to record with my sons, you know, for an album, and then, you know, be able to listen to it. I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, it's ultimately it's history, you know, and. Thankfully, you know, with God Forbid, we were never the biggest band in the world, but people still seem to care. Those who are fans of the band, and there is some, you know, it's, we made a mark, whatever that mark is, and I'm glad that we could bring you into that, you know, yeah. and we'll always have that no matter what.
Yeah, well, it's not Casablanca, but
All right. Well, Dad, I love you. I really appreciate you taking the time doing this.
Love you too, Doc. We could do this again in about maybe 20 years when more stuff is.
Well, we'll see. Maybe I'll make you a correspondent. You know, you can come. You know, talk shit about, you know, whoever the president is or something, and you know, you can have fun with that. You know.
Nah, it'll get you arrested. You don't want to get
okay. Control. All right. Well, watch those. Dad, I love you. I'll talk to you later. Thank you for being on the show. I really appreciate it.
Okay, bye.
Bye. So that was The Lonely Dead from God Forbid's album for Constitution of Treason, in which my father, Kevin Coyle, played piano on that track, that outro there, which he completely improvised. You know, we gave him the chords, which is pretty much just a chromatic chord progression. And, you know, he brought that jazz in there, and it's amazing. It's a really beautiful moment, and really proud to kind of bring my father into my musical legacy to a certain degree. It's a shame we haven't collaborated more, but I hope you guys enjoyed that. Like I said, it's things like this, you know, it's personal for me. And like I said, there's things in that conversation I haven't even asked my dad about. So there's something about the podcast that allows you to kind of peer further. It feels a little more important. So I don't know. It's a great format for that, having kind of these official type conversations. And I really appreciate that. Hope you enjoyed my father. He's a funny guy. Whatever, you can see some of the similarities between humor and, you know, I was a little annoyed at myself. I was listening back and I was thinking, I say, you know, a lot. And then I hear my dad go, he says, you know, a lot. So it's not completely my fault. He gave it to me. Anyway, that was fun. Thank you, Dad. I love you. Of course, appreciate it. And yeah, I was actually, there's a couple things I felt remiss. I realized I didn't say in the first part, even though it was belabored to begin with. And like I said, if you're still listening, I give you, you know, give a couple of those. I appreciate it. But, you know, just to make a general point, I really believe that the most important thing about where we're at right now is division, polarization. And so, like, I want to look at myself and see, what am I doing that's either pushing people apart or bringing people together? And I want to be on the bringing people together end of things. And I watched a couple documentaries. PBS has one on the election. Just, you know, it's basically a profile of Trump and Biden. And, you know, at first I thought, you know, you think, oh, it's just going to be all lefty and anti-Trump. But I think it's actually fairly critical of kind of the tough times that Biden has had and some of the kind of mistakes he's made. So I do think it kind of reflects both candidates pretty well and is worth watching. So it's part of their Frontline series. And then there's a two-part documentary called Agents of Chaos by Alex Gibney, who did the documentary on Scientology, Going Clear. He did a few other ones I can't remember off the top of my head, but it's essentially about the entire kind of Russian intelligence operation, about their entire kind of social media, internet, you know, spy, whatever you want to call it. I forget the name of it. Oh, it's the internet something agency that they have over there. But really fascinating, really in depth, and goes completely into like their methodologies on, you know, basically the stuff that they used here. Keep in mind they tried it, they did in the Ukraine previously. So like the first episode was all about the organization, stuff they did in Ukraine and how it kind of came together, how it works, how the troll farms work. And the whole second half is how that kind of affected, you know, the U.S. side of it, you know, and it goes into the whole Russian collusion thing and Mueller report, all that stuff. But it's really fascinating because their main goal is for us to be against each other and kind of make us lose trust in each other and our institutions and our electoral system. And so that's a long way around what I said at the beginning about us being against each other, is that when if you're someone, and I got, you know, kind of into it with a friend of mine, you know, who's just like one of these people who's like, well, I don't believe anything. I don't believe the news. I don't believe the government. And I'm like, well, what do you believe then? How do you get a fact? You know, and I don't think people really understand that when you get to the point where I don't believe anything or anyone, then there's a vested interest in you being like that. And that means someone else is one for you not to believe anything. And so, and they, and people will look at me and say, oh, well, you're just a sap, right? You just believe anything they tell you. I'm like, no, there's everything does not exist in two polar extremes of where either you don't believe anything or you believe everything. No, you need some form of consensus and verification, you know, how you ascertain what is real and what's not. And so, you know, and this unfortunately leads to a lot of, you know, I talked a little bit about conspiratorial thinking. It's not, unfortunately, people look, oh, you call it a conspiracy, so that means it's like almost like a derogatory term. And so instead of calling someone a conspiracy theorist, I think what's more important to criticize is the idea of conspiratorial thinking, because it's a map that you put on it's a filter that you put on the world, and then you interpret the world through that. And so, especially with this Trump getting COVID thing, you had conspiracies happen in real, I saw them, people literally, and you know, say, oh, where did they get that idea from? You know where they got it from? They pulled it out of their fucking ass. And I have people very close to me who are like, oh, clearly he's faking it. Or, oh, wow, it's weird, only Republicans got sick. Clearly they were dosed or something. And this is, so everyone has their form of conspiracy. And I try to explain it. I'm like, that's your gut, your intuition wants a narrative. And unfortunately, with the Trump administration, they've at least earned this because of how unreliable they are in terms of being transparent and letting you know what's really happening. You've seen that through this whole process. And this becomes more easier to manipulate, you know, when you're more conspiracy minded, because you're just like, you're seeing shadow puppets everywhere, and you have to create a framework where you can be resilient to that. You know, I don't really know what to tell you, but it's not a great filter for the world. Like, I was trying to explain something to, like, what do you mean? How do you know he didn't fake it? I'm like, by doing some critical thinking. It only takes a little bit, right? I'll give you this example. Here's why he's not faking it. One, Trump thinks sickness is weakness. So he would never intentionally make himself look weak. That's the one thing. Second thing, the amount of people you would have to get on board to fake that would be so tremendous. You have to get everyone in the White House, all the doctors, it's just too much. It's too much work. And then what about everyone else who got sick? Are they all faking being sick too? It doesn't really make sense. Then you take into the account that then he couldn't campaign like he was normally. He couldn't do certain events. And this man is behind in the polls by a lot. So he needs the campaign events and he needs the debates to help get the numbers back on board. If he just sits it out and he's sick, he can't do that. So it makes no logical sense. Like, oh, well, people, oh, maybe. No. Critical thinking. All right. I said, it would be harder for them to do all this stuff to fake it than for him just to be sick. It makes no sense. So anyway, and that's just giving you an idea. And the same thing with this guy. Clearly they were targeted and they were made sick, or they're careless and they think it's a hoax and they think masks don't work and all this crap. They're not careful. They thought they're untouchable and they're not. And it's real and it happens. So that's what happens there. So anyway, stop with the conspiracies. Use critical thinking. Doesn't mean conspiracies don't actually happen sometimes. It's just if something, an event happens and your first reaction is the real story is fake without any evidence, then you think conspiratorially. You're not being skeptical. You are literally inventing things out of thin air. Use evidence. You might be onto something, but make sure, you know, it's okay to think about these things, but don't get too hyped up in them. Anyway. Yep, this is a lot of monologuing for Doc Coyle, telling people, like it is, man. I should be doing this from a car. You know, if I do this in my car, then people really take me seriously. It's the only place you can pontificate. Anyway, I'm sure you guys are sick of me by now, so I'm going to get going. But anyway, you guys do well. You take care of each other. Remember, we're all in this together. And the more together we are, the more we're going to get through it. It's going to be a long month, but I feel positive. I'm going to stay positive. All right. Love you guys. Mom out.